Pathology of intestinal obstruction. There are four types in acute intestinal obstruction. First of all, simple obstruction. As we said before, simple obstruction means obstruction of the intestine with intact blood supply of the intestine. In simple occlusion, there is obstruction. The intestine distal to the obstruction. Normal intestine with normal peristalsis, normal digestion, normal absorption. Until the distal part of the intestine becomes empty and evacuate itself normally. When the distal part becomes empty, it becomes immobile, contracted. This leads to nothing will pass in the intestine, in this distal part. And this appears as absolute constipation. Absolute constipation means the patient doesn't pass feces or filetus. Because the distal part of the intestine distal to the obstruction is empty and collapsed. The intestine proximal to the obstruction. What happened? First of all, the intestine proximal to the obstruction becomes slightly distended. Once the intestine distended, this leads to visceral pain. As we discussed before in acute appendicitis, visceral pain is diffuse, ill-defined pain. Therefore, distension of the intestine with content, leading first of all to pain. And the pain is visceral pain, which is ill-defined and diffuse. Slight distension of the muscle layer of the intestine stimulate hyperperistalsis to overcome the obstruction. This leads to appearance of hyperperistalsis leading to colicky pain. We all know that in the GIT, there is peristalsis and the anti-peristalsis to prolong the duration of the food in the intestine, allowing time for digestion and absorption. And the strength of peristalsis is corresponding to the strength of anti-peristalsis. The peristalsis fails to overcome the obstruction and to pass the food against the obstruction. But anti-peristalsis, which is very strong, the way is patent proximally. And the anti-peristalsis leading to vomiting. Vomiting under the effect of anti-peristalsis. I give you advice, never stand in front of a patient with mechanical intestinal obstruction. Why? Vomiting by the effect of hyper antibristalsis. Vomiting with hyper antibristalsis leading to this. Projectile vomiting. Never stand in front of a patient with mechanical intestinal obstruction. And this is a famous projectile vomiting in mechanical intestinal obstruction. If the obstruction persists, marked distension occur in the muscle layer and the wall of the intestine. Severe distension of the muscle layer leading to flaccidity and failure of the muscle layer to bypass the obstruction. Flaccidity and the failure of the muscles leading to stasis and infection, because the intestine is full of bacterial flora. Stasis with infection. Infection leading to fermentation and gas formation. And the intestine becomes markedly distended with gas and the fluid. What is the source of the gas and what's the source of the fluid? 70% of the gas are the swallowed air, plus 10% fermentation due to infection of the contents and the stasis, and about 20% diffusion of gas from the congested wall of the intestine. Why congested wall? Because due to high pressure in the lumen. The high pressure in the lumen compress the wall. Compression of the wall leading to occlusion of the veins in the wall of the intestine. Occlusion in the wall of the intestine leading to congested wall. And the congestion of the wall leading to diffusion of gas and the fluid from the wall to the lumen. And in this case, the intestine becomes not absorbing the organ. It becomes a secretory organ. Secrete gas and the fluid inside the lumen. What is the source of the fluid? The source of gas is swallowed air, 70%, plus diffusion from the congested wall and the fermentation. What is the source of the fluid? Normal GIT secretion is 8 liters per day, plus diffusion from the wall of the from congested intestine. This is the mechanism of simple strangulation. If the condition is neglected, what happened? The high pressure inside the lumen will compress the wall, leading to occlusion of the veins, followed by transudation of fluid and gases in the lumen, leading to more increased pressure in the lumen. More increased pressure in the lumen will compress more the wall. More compression on the wall will compress and occlude the arterial supply of the affected segment. And occlusion of the arterial supply, the wall becomes devitalized. And if the condition is not treated, moist septic gangrene of the intestine, followed by perforation and acute generalized septic peritonitis occur. The first layer affected by ischemia and undergo sloughing is the mucosa. Sloughing of the mucosa leading to ulceration of the mucosa and intraluminal hemorrhage. Intraluminal hemorrhage leading to increased pressure inside the lumen with more compression on the wall, leading to more devitalization of the wall. Through the devitalized wall, the bacteria and toxins can pass through the devitalized wall. Passage of bacteria and toxins through the devitalized wall reach and irritate the overlying peritoneum. Irritation of the overlying parietal peritoneum, as we take before in appendicitis, irritation of parietal peritoneum leading to sharp localized somatic pain, because the parietal peritoneum lining the anterior abdominal wall is supplied by somatic nerves, leading to somatic pain which is sharp localized. Plus diffusion of bacteria and toxins into the generalized peritoneal cavity leading to acute generalized septic peritonitis. with passage of this material, bacteria and toxins into the blood, leading to septic shock and toxic shock. This is the mechanism which occur in the second type of intestinal obstruction, which is strangulation. The third type of intestinal obstruction is this. What is this? A very serious type of obstruction called the closed loop obstruction. The typical type of closed loop obstruction is valveless. This segment is closed from both sides, containing feces, bacteria inside the lumen with rapid fermentation, rapid increased pressure in the lumen, rapid compression on the wall leading to rapid strangulation and gangrene. This type in which the obstruction includes a segment of intestine which becomes occluded from both sides is called the closed loop obstruction. Closed loop obstruction. The fourth type of obstruction is neurogenic obstruction. Neurogenic obstruction, failure of neuromuscular transmission in the intestine, leading to paralysis of the muscle layer of the intestine. Obstruction due to paralysis of the muscle layer, we all know that ileus means obstruction. Obstruction with paralysis, therefore this is the paralytic ileus. These are the four types of intestinal obstruction pathologically: simple obstruction, strangulation, closed loop obstruction, and the neurogenic obstruction. What are the complications of intestinal obstruction? The complications of intestinal obstruction are various types of shock. What are the various types of shock? Severe pain, severe hyperbristalsis, severe colicky pain, severe irritation of parietal peritoneum, severe pain leading to neurogenic shock, repeated vomiting leading to loss of fluids and electrolytes leading to hypovolemic shock, plus intraluminal hemorrhage, ulceration of the mucosa and the hemorrhage inside the lumen leading to more and more hypovolemic shock. The bacteria which migrate through the wall to the generalized peritoneal cavity, and the surface area of the generalized peritoneal cavity is very huge surface area. Absorption of bacteria from this huge surface area in peritonitis leading to bacteremia and septic shock. Toxic material absorbed from the peritoneum leading to toxic shock. Repeated vomiting. In our system, we all know that any repeated vomiting predisposes to respiratory complication, inhalation pneumonia, bronchitis, bronchopneumonia, lung abscess, etc. Therefore, there is repeated vomiting with liability of respiratory complication. Sure, the most severe complication is strangulation leading to gangrene, perforation, and peritonitis. These are the complications of intestinal obstruction. Thank you for good listening and good luck.